during COVID has kind of deadened the work, and it's such a shame. So this is a really great experience, I think, for even though mine was not in it, for people to come together and, you know, have a lively discussion and exchange. So just to introduce myself, I'm Jillian Knipe. I host a podcast called Art Fictions, and just in case you haven't listened to it, it is all about stories, so it's very nice to be asked to, kind of direct the traffic here for this discussion today, because I'm really quite committed to stories that run, if you like, in parallel to an art practice. Thank you very much, Robin Fitzmaurice, who is the curator of this show, who came up with the idea, and we've got the Arts Council funding with much stress. I'm writing this at the moment, and I'm just thinking, you know what, I just don't want to do this anymore. So well done for seeing that through. I thought maybe we'd start by talking a little bit about the curatorial platform for the show and the idea that came out of reading some of Isabel Graff's writing, which I struggle with myself. So again, welcome there.
Okay, so I'll try and keep it brief because I may play off a few rabbit holes here. There, and that's part of my interest in rabbit holes and reading. But that's running in back in to 2019. I was lucky enough to get certified by Sasha Crabb to get the Creekside open. And that was the first time I saw space. And what we're sitting here today, basically, I saw space and asked myself an odd question. That's why. What would I do with the space if I managed to secure it? What's the work in there? So the space actually came first. Sometimes it was a show. It would be a theme first, and then have the venue here as part of the the theme itself comes from a book by Isabel Graff, and the main head is still in the press, the whole series of books, she's on the book. There's a little thin time. Let me explain where the theme came from the phrase about technical works. As an author, it was the phrase first. The artwork, she was talking specifically about painting, but I would say the artwork contains the ghostly presence of the absent author. Now, subsequently, in conversation with artists, people have said, well, of course it does, but it's a somehow got me thinking about the different ways that the artist. Still, in-depth in work and quite proximal, or they're quite distant from the moment of some moment, the traces are still there. And that's what I've tried to show in this exhibition. I don't know if that's too much.
Well, it sounds fantastic.
Okay.
So, it's quite clear on that. So, just to introduce the artist, I mean, I gather you all know at least one of the people here. We have Allison Goodyear. Do you want to just point to where your work is?
I'm behind you. Yes, it's very nice. Yes,
Yellow brick road. Sorry, can we also have Kelly Sweeney? We have Luke's and just here, not from the school. Kelly Duong, who I say, is that speak for the performance that created this fantastic piece of work here.
Because that's my former and a few sculptural pieces.
And you've got a little gallery window as well. And we've got Kirsty House.
We've got a painting here, Jeff's Nine painting in the window.
Well, so there's two pieces. Please come to the front. We've really just started, so we're just going through the introducing the artist, so I'm not sure who knows who here, but we've got Robert Fitzmaurice, who's the curator of the exhibition, and we've got Alison Goodyear, and we've got Kelly Sweeney, Kaylee
Throughout your life recently or last night.
story resonates with a lot of people.
so when I think the, and it just quite in line with what was earlier in this year, that was for a charity project to raise funds for an SDO fund actually. And that are 9 portraits of the splendor and lockdown. So I asked the friends and their acquaintances to send me a model photo of themselves, and I've overlaid it with sourced images of their profession. And everyone is asked and it's done in this manner to portray or collective experience of the past 1.5 years. And the process of making it, this transfer method on the steel, the model steel, you get these marks through remove the paper, you get this rusting, which is both unique and also unpredictable, just like our experience of COVID, individual and being either physical or mental. So the two pieces have different narratives, but they are both humans and our relationships and our experiences.
Yeah, I just thought that was such a perfect connection between the two. It's an name trapped here. Because, yeah, we stumble on something that you can't see in the same way that ancestral trauma.
Both come from some childhood experience, but that's a first for me working on that.
And it's it's interesting the use of the word entities, because even though these are physical manifestations, either as a sculpture or as an image, where things are located quite specifically in, let's say, a character, you maintain them to be entities as if they sort of shift and change, and they're almost like vessels or ideas that you have.
Yeah, they feel like entities to me, you know, the kind of changing maneuver throughout practice. And I try, I think about my own relationship with the mother, I sort of try to just stay out there where I am. You know, I kind of very much feel like there's a sort of conflict of entities, if you like, and I'm sure there'll be more emerging. Sometimes I do quite often, anyway, it's quite a but that definitely was the case, but the painting was sort of just for the show, because that had very elements, very that had a destination, the lessons that led me to everyone was on the way. But it was, I did paintings first, then the sculptures came in relation to paintings.
Okay.
So the sculpture in the window uses the same palette as the painting, so the fabric has been the same too, so it has a relationship.
The one that moves.
Well, the three spot, yeah, I mean,
So moving on to Madi now. Madi, you are in some ways in the sort of least control of your work, because you source all your materials from vastly different places. So you're saying to me that there's a lot of bead work and you purchase beads, which connect to your own personal history and with when it comes to Indian textiles, but other than that, it's to add
I do realise that it's a different place of work, it's not square to work. But that very, very important to something that I have to do with this is unfortunate to the world about living in that influence change as well. That's sharing, seeing it all in different ways. It has important itself, I'm just thank you making my artwork, although there is a lot of time spent in the studio on making my work just like you can work.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's also a sense of the change of value of something, because, you know, if you pick up something that's discarded and you can pull it together as part of an art piece, and I know you've worked quite intricately on some of those pieces, it's not just sticking bits together, if you like. That changes the sort of cumulative value of what it is that we see those things. And obviously, so, moving on to quite a different practice, Alison, you are really quite committed to a more digital world, but you started in painting. How do you
think? Yeah, so I still see these as paintings.
Yeah.
And I still do physical paint. These are digital works, it's not my work, yeah. Physical and digital combined, yes, although it's Marmite terms that you can fill it up on it. So I use a photograph of my physical paint palette, and I walk back into virtual reality, and then I work, use that as a base to work on. So that's mapping, tracing, extrapolating, and by that I mean making 2D work, 3D. I use software called Tiltbrush, and that allows you to effectively paint in three dimensions. It has tools which are very painterly. There's gorgeous gloss and textures and really painting, lovely painting qualities. And then there are other brushes like painting on the brain. I mean, there's the neon, there's the pulses, there's animating stuff. So I like to explore that kind of looking at things that we understand, you know, kind of similar to paint, and then those that are definitely moving far away from that. So by wanting this photograph and working on it, I'm combining the sort of thinking about painting whilst making painting.
Yeah.
The painting is on the loosest terms, because obviously when I paint in 3D, it's very painterly to me, but then it's how I output that. Change relationships with how people encounter it. So obviously with a normal painting, we're usually two-dimensional, more often than not, and usually on a surface, whether it's a canvas or paper or something like that. I like to sort of bring the VR out into the physical world, so I have before printed onto silk, the virtual paintings, and painted on the canvas, stretched that silk over the original canvas, and then fly further painting, so you've got the digital and the virtual combined. And then I might project on top of that. And with these works, because the space and kind of the we can work through and the time in it as well, I decided to produce them as the films. And these are my slow things in the films. So I'm always thinking about that relationship between the maker and the beholder of the work, and how we might manipulate or encourage different types of relationships as an artist. So slow paintings are encouraging you to hang on a little more. Some of them, at some point, the slow paintings very slowly, and you might think that it's a still image. And then other times, another quite like at the moment, because you've got one going very quite fast and one going very slow. And they ask you to linger a little longer. You know, sometimes it's really easy to see something entirely apart, so it's presented, first of all, that one looking. These works might be deemed theatrical because they're not present ones. They kind of keep unfolding, so you're never entirely sure what the whole thing might be. So, hang on a bit, there's a bit more from it. Yeah. And then we've got the prints here, kind of me thinking about painting as plates. So, with the virtual reality works, you can create a VR encounter that is on the headset and explore the painting in VR itself. And when you do that, if the paintings are around you completely, you can walk through. And that's where the whole idea of painting into place evolves. The prints come from that idea of creating watercolours of landscape. But this is kind of, obviously, it's not a real landscape, it's a landscape, it's a painting landscape. It's kind of, I don't really know what it is yet, it's experimental in that
respect. I mean, it's quite interesting because a lot of painters that, and certainly traditional painters, they say, modern painters, who work with these sort of abstract expressionist kind of painting, are so committed to the physical paint existing. Whereas you've taken it into the digital realm, and I'm just wondering, is it because there's something not satisfactory or something frustrating about that? I mean, how did that transition?
Yeah.
That's quite a drastic transition. Not for any of us logically, but it is for a painter.
Yeah, I don't know. I think so. I think there are a lot of filmmakers that use paintings, and it's something to do with light and colour that people. It's not just stuff in paint. It's our relationship to the image that's unfolded, whether that can be still or moving. So for me, prior to being an artist, I worked as a graphic designer and illustrator. So I spent a hell of a lot of time in Photoshop land, like 12 hours a day, staring at the screen. And it was after then I went on to my MA and onwards, pictures and all that. And yeah, I combined the two. Second nature thing. Love stuff and what you can do with it. And then chuck it out of him and do some more stuff with it, you know. So I really like pushing boundaries of what digital allows to do physical and what physical could bring out in the digital. So whether that's installations, still painting, still print, a movie, a VR encounter, all of this AR as well, that's something else we're exploring. So I love toying with all those boundaries and seeing what that can for the audience, you know, when there are works that are produced which are generative. So when people are in VR encountering the VR paintings, are they monitored eye tracking time in particular? So you can see what they focus on a certain time. So they choose the brush, the marks that they've stared at. Take them out, extrapolate them, and do that every week that's been in that painting. So you get like the top 10 favourite marks, and create that painting from them. So that's, so it's kind of participation as well. And I like that thing that an audience could be part, or is part of the work, in all sorts of ways.
Yeah, definitely. So let's move on to you, Robert. This is interesting to me, it may not be interesting to anybody else, but when I saw your paintings, I immediately thought, this is the only one that's in this space. I didn't immediately think of stained glass windows and very formal finishes of the signs. Because I grew up in Australia, we don't really do stained glass much anywhere. So I'm really interested in, you know, moving to this country and going traveling a little bit in Europe. So that was my main connection. I went to that weird museum and to go and look at stained glass windows. But they also have that thing of undulating with the texture. And we had a brief conversation about you going to Coventry Cathedral as a child and looking at the Southern tapestry. So perhaps you can talk a little bit about where your work's coming from.
Yeah, sure. Well, I'll put the stained glass comment in the topic, because that is relevant. But let's start with the cathedral. I grew up in Britain and this ordinary drug in Coventry from about 6. And if you don't know Coventry Cathedral or cathedrals, there's an old monastery about the 16th century, it's got no roof anymore, and down the steps connected to it, it's very, very old for modern time construction of modern Coventry Cathedral. Inside that, a lot of stained glass windows, about the space. There is this enormous giant glass tapestry designed by the great Solomon, and then it's a main famous Gotland or somewhere else. But anyway, it's an enormous tapestry. But why is that important? As a little kid, just totally blew me away the size of the figure, and I knew. And it's from Talty. I wasn't aware of the terms at the time, but the way the figure was composed was not. The full title of the piece is Christ in Glory in the Tetramorph. And the Tetramorph is enclosed in that border, which you find in other cultures as well. It's large, sort of haunted ellipse, if you like, which has all sorts of connotations. It's possible to be in that in glory. You can see the arts and the name. And this followed me away at the size of the thing and so on. So the piece of this year, through conversations with various people in the NDR world, from the book out, that's a motivation for me. That I really like to see how much if we jump, there's a lot more to say. If we jump quickly to your point about stained glass, for many years I was working inspired by lost periods working in my space. Fairly modernist civilian expressions. But I always struggled with the figurative thing. I was never quite happy in the figures of the camera, but the figure was actually essential to my interest. And I was like, I'm very, very motivated to understand the context of painting, the language of painting, liberated from the subject. I've never really fully understood the data. But I wanted to land somewhere in between. And as with many, certainly modern things, I think the rigs of trying to have a figure ground relationship, and certainly stained glass does that. You know, not being really easy, that's just fairly random, and then the lead in goes, and it's right. Well, I can't do that with composition, as so my figures in front of them, they're all of them. It's quite hard to determine whether they're in the
nation. That's right, yeah.
And quite often, figures are emerging and they're constantly going on. So, just one thing that I want to add before we get to the questions about it. You may be asking for a friend about the chose to buy what you did in all this book, Sand. Great writer. Never wrote a novel. Wonder they wrote a novel. Just incredible short stories. very concerned about that.
Which is then
Yeah.
stories we tell ourselves of our offspring and so on are so important, and making those connections across culture, seeing the artists and echoes and so on, it's understanding is, I think, it's so important to kind of unravel the sign of the thinking between us and the rest. So, it's something that I wanted to try and bring stories from different cultures into this exhibition.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose it comes back to, the intention of the work, and that varies through different artists, where what you may have a sense that you intend to do becomes very different. The output becomes very different. And that might connect to, I don't know, something that happened last week or this morning or, you know, 20 years ago. And that, you know, how are you talking about your sculpture that starts at the bottom and builds up and you're not really sure what it's going to look like. So, do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, I mean, it isn't how you work before with the show.
Bombs, loot,
might not be your hands. So that same movement of painting with the body going up and down because you were limited, I didn't actually know what was going to come out, and it just came out as it did. I sort of rehearsed prior, just to have some context of having a road map from A to B. But there are actual driving, you take detours and you pit stops, that's what happens with their performance. And the fact that it came out the way it did, and someone commenting that it looks a bit like watermelon, which is a bit spooky, and actually there's a handprint which turned out very prevalent to the final work, and that process when I was performing, that was just instinctive. You're just doing something. But actually, it turned out to be such a strong piece of that that was completely unplanned. And of course, the burning afterwards, I had in mind burning in the middle and coming up sort of a tip. But of course, when I started burning, the wind blew. So the right piece, it burned the right piece off. Yeah, that was like the center triangle, which that was not intended. But actually it is what it is. That's what the effect is. So some of it is planned and some of it is what comes up by the weather and the response of the audience. And also how you're feeling that day as well. And all of these performances are site specific. So I did one 2 years ago in the middle of Soho. This was heaving summer where the people were about a meter away from me, so that environment was completely different from here.
Did you feel like, I mean this quite seriously, do you feel like you're sort of channeling or trying to connect with your parents in your mind when you're and your grandparents and aunts and uncles?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think as a kid, I played Luigi more. But I'm not so superstitious.
Yeah.
I think people pray or to become religious when they're in dire situations. Like they're in the trenches, and they're about to demolish and pray. It's something supernatural that I'm not aware of.
Yeah.
Also, the burning process. Western world, it's like the rise of the phoenix from the ashes, kind of rebirth, the resurrection. In the Asian culture, the Chinese culture, you're burning jaws of paper, which is the molder paper with the colors being poured out to how it's been put into houses, and you burn that in ceremonies to give to your ancestors. So that process where I burned it was to pay homage to my ancestors. So maybe that came through your the performance that wasn't well.
Yeah, definitely something about the difference between retreating and projecting or rising up. Drastically different. I want to move on to the idea of digital interference, because once we create something through a digital means, you're relying on software, obviously, that's kind of much more under your control. And yet, obviously I'm pointing towards you, a question for you, Alison, but, anybody can respond to this, but there's something about your watercolors that reminded me of Japanese anime and studio movie films and watching Princess Mononoke for the 10th time or whatever, but they're really awesome.
Yes.
Yeah.
You go back to the things that the new mother, we've got prints and, homes and landscape comes through. I mean, we talk about the incidental nature of the landscape being the accident. I can set about many of these paintings as landscapes, but it was only on experience painting as a three-dimensional thing, maybe lakes, that
aware of myself in that space. Even though we are, you're not there. I don't know how many people have encountered the art, but you're disembodied. I mean, there are sort of new tech, you can see your hands, certain games and gadgets, and guns and what have you. But more often than not, you're not present. You're looking in and you're moving around. Your body's not there. So,
you really are absent. Change, and I think that there's been a lot of rethinking over COVID and lockdown. And I just want to put one more issue to the group before we hand over to questions, which is about the time we've had over the last 12, 18 months, 2 years. In fact, somebody posted something on Instagram this morning and said, I'll do something rather I did last year. I'm like, I don't know what year it is. But there's something that Maggie said on the phone to me yesterday about how, you know, what's really lovely about this exhibition in particular is that it's brought together a really diverse group insofar as, you know, it's not like we're having an exhibition about, you know, digital painting, or we're having an exhibition about fairy stories in painting or whatever it might be, but to sort of have an exhibition on an idea that you can pick up all sorts of artists has been a really interesting way to kind of think about your work. And I know that Rob was talking before about silo thinking about, I think you were talking about East and West, and we have a lot of, you know, with Black Lives Matter, we've had a lot of assertion of artists from, what was it? I'm just trying to remember the name of the painter. Christine Quartz was talking about people on all sorts of spectrums, for instance, in terms of skin colour and how ridiculous it is that we are still thinking in these sort of siloed ways. And we want, she said she found that during lockdown in her area, was that people were talking much more on a spectrum, and these dividing lines were starting to break down. And also, Kirsty, you were talking to me about, you know, what we've seen over lockdown is a not only a sort of universal concern, but also the capacity for drastic change. And I know that artists have changed their practice over lockdown. So does anybody want to talk about their experience in lockdown, how that's affected their studio practice and what that's affected?
Well, finally, I started that painting for COVID and then left it the whole lockdown.
Okay.
And then went back to it again this January. Just because I felt a bit too dramatic to be doing a massive painting in the middle of all this turmoil, and instead I kind of turned to doing little paintings for our own, wanted to spend time while we were waiting to be shielded, they wanted to be on his own the whole time if I was in the studio, so I doing little paintings at home on the table again, which ended up being snakes. And so, I don't know.
I would say
artists that have shown their resilience in a lot of ways. Losing the studio, not ideal, but unlike other sectors of the creative industries, like theatre, orchestras, live performance, really taken a hit. Still so bad. But it's been really amazing to see how artists have flexed and kind of changed their work in practices. I mean, I am a studio that has that's why those paintings were produced. I had the option to spend a smack out to the people in this kind of place, but I didn't. I was like, slowly.
Yeah.
Right, yeah, in the bottom line. turning it and running it back and take some kind of.
To answer your question, when a lot of people were bored during lockdown and trying to fill their days with Zoom calls and quizzes and baking, I was the boss. I still worked full time, but actually I was supposed to do 6 months sabbatical, but not that long, canceled because of COVID. And so I went up to 4 day working week and I had 3 days to think, and actually the mornings and evenings as well. And I think if the period solidified anything is that it's such a privilege to be courageous during lockdown, because while you were lost and constrained in the physical group, you're able to escape intellectually and mentally to create work, and you're almost lost in the normality of creating work because you're there and you're exploring yourself. And in that way, I felt really free.
That's why
arts
education is so,
sorry,
it is.
Yeah, so it was to solidify, I think. It's like, yes, of course I want to be a full-time artist. And I think for everyone else, it's like, this is what we really want to do.
Yeah, I think it's a really interesting observation, actually. My last year was different. I didn't have this period to stop it after I got used to it. And I was actually about to
really big art, isn't it? I mean, I started this the new work in May. Before that, I had a show, so I'm really grateful for what you said. I know what I'm doing, and I will put it off, but I don't have anything to like give you or show you, and so I'm very grateful for that. Really trust it. Yeah, maybe like that, and that's where I'm drawing my head and thinking before it was coming here. And so it's been the last conversation really, really full of love up until we saw the conversation earlier on. I'm definitely craving some offering of time.
Yeah.
If that's possible.
Speaking of time, we're right on finishing time. Almost quite perfectly, which is pretty good for me anyway, because I'm almost late. So we're going to go and explain the authorship, but in the words of Sasha Craddock, who has written a fantastic essay, which is in the limited edition dossier, which you can purchase still. Words cannot make something exist in the same way that an artwork is never the equivalent of existence. I think what's particularly great about that in the context of art education and funding and all that sort of stuff is that, you know, art becomes essential to understand what this thing of our human condition and our own existence is, which is simultaneously very common. There's a lot of commonalities amongst all of us in this room and all of us in general, and also very individual and independent, which we've unearthed a little bit of that today from all the artists. So thank you very much. Thank you, Robert. Thank you trusting me, artists, to kind of help direct the flow of their conversation. Thanks to APT Gallery, thank you to the Arts Council for funding, and thank you guys for coming. Thank you very much.